Thank you all for attending the December 11th meeting of the Kershaw County Council. We would like to start the meeting with an invocation and a pledge of allegiance. We will be led by Councilman Sammy Tucker. I'd please like to ask everyone to stand. Thank you.
Let us all bow our heads and open our hearts, please. God, Father Almighty, we say thank you once again for another gorgeous day, gorgeous week that you brought us through. Lord, Father, we thank you for the season that we're celebrating now here, which is the birth of your Son, Jesus Christ. And we ask that each and every one of us have a blessed Christmas and holidays as we continue to go through them. And Lord, Father, I ask for a special blessing for Robert Bobby Gary as he leave us after this evening to embark upon new endeavors, that you bless he and his family, to watch over God and strengthen them. Lord, Father, and I ask that you bless our minds and our hearts as we deliberate the people's business. Give thanks for the men and women who have protected our freedoms throughout our lives. We ask all these things in your Son, Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Councilman Tucker. Chair would like to make a statement concerning Councilman Miles. Mr. Miles had his first grandson delivered about 3 or 4 hours to do, ago. Charles Ray Miles the fourth, so he won't be here.
I have a picture of C.R.'s brain. Actually, Alan Trapp gave me this.
Nine pounds, 2 ounces. Next item on the agenda is public comments. It's a time for the members of the public to speak to County Council, and the County Council will listen to those comments. Mr. DuBose, do we have anybody signed up?
Got one signed up.
Thank you. Next item on the agenda is the adoption of tonight's agenda. The chair will entertain a motion to adopt tonight's agenda.
So moved.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. It's unanimous. Next item on the agenda is a public hearing in regards to an ordinance adopting an amendment to the Comprehensive Plan 5-year review. The public hearing is now open. Any member of the audience can come forward to comment on the county's 5-year comprehensive plan. Public hearing is closed. Next item is another public hearing in regards to the Edward Byrne Memorial Justice Assistant Grant, JAG. This is for the cameras and the sheriff's vehicles. I believe it's for $16,000. The public hearing is now open. Mr. Maddox.
Good evening, Council. This grant has just come to my attention in the last day or so, and we did a little bit of research into it. As you know, most of these federal grants come with some sort of strings attached to them. And one of the things that is attached to this one is that the OJP, which is the Bureau Office of Justice Programs, requires that the guarantee to comply with the DOJ's Global Justice Information Sharing Initiative. And what this is a global database. And there are concerns right now about information going to central locations and all, and more of our data being collected by governments in particular. We've had hacking incidents and all that are kind of they're related to it, but the concern that I have is that now that we're accepting this grant, we take this And one of the things that, is included in it are things like the nationally adopted standards, the architecture and guidelines, including fusion center guidelines, global reference architecture, national information exchange model, and the national criminal intelligence sharing plan. Now, that kind of sounds good, and it, we're looking at any kind of criminal involved, but it's a slippery slope once we get to that point where we start sharing this information all around the world. You never know when something's going to come up and you're going to be stopped, and they got your information pulled up in front of you. When is that going to end? How much secrecy, how much privacy are we going to accept? What I'm asking is for time. I don't know, I haven't had time enough to research what all the strings that are attached to this. And it concerns me that we're looking at something that, don't get me wrong, I want cameras, I want bulletproof vests and all, but I don't want all these strings attached to them. And so I just ask that you guys maybe take a little bit more time. Let us have a little time to do some research. Let us get you informed at what you're voting for, because I don't think we all know what we're voting for here tonight. It sounds good, but maybe it's not. So I'm just asking for a little time. Thanks, guys.
Would anyone else like to come forward and speak during this period? Public hearing is closed. Next on the agenda is a public presentation by our auditing company, Shaheen Hancock and Godwin. Mr. Mark Wood will be making the presentation. Mr. Wood.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Members of council, hope everybody's doing good tonight. You should find on your in front of you a copy of the audit report, but I've also given each one of you a copy of the one-page summary, and this is what I'd like to go over with you guys tonight. Start off with, the county received an unqualified opinion again this year, which is the highest opinion that we can render, so congratulations to the county once again for that. Kind of go through these in the different bullets that I have. Your audit report is made up of five different sections. You've got your management discussion and analysis, which are on pages 3 through 12. Your basic financial statements, which are on pages 13 through 24. Your notes to the financials, which are on pages 25 through 53. The supplemental schedules, which are more detailed fund schedules that give more detail of the schedules in the basic financial statements on pages 56 through 86, and your compliance, internal control letters, any findings that we had are on pages 88 through page 100. Of course, the county has three different types of funds. You have your governmental funds, which is your general fund, which is the general operating fund. You have your special revenue funds, debt service and capital projects. You have one proprietary fund, which is your sewer fund, and you have fiduciary funds. You have an agency fund for the school district, and you have various trust funds. I'm going to run through 3, 4, and 5, and I'm going to do the general fund first, and we'll come back to the sewer fund, if that's okay. Total assets for the general fund were $13.2 million. Total liabilities were $4.8 million, which left fund balance at $8.3 million. Now, of the fund balance, the makeup of that is $2,600 is non-spendable. That's related to inventories. $241,000 is restricted. $958,000 has been committed. That leaves an unassigned or unrestricted fund balance of $7.1 million. I'll just kind of go ahead and say that, you know, the rule of thumb is usually 3 to 6 months that you want to have in your unrestricted fund balance. The county right now has about 4 months, so you're right in line with that. Total revenues were $21.4 million. Expenses were a little over $22 million. Transfers and other financing sources were about $70,000. So your change in fund balance was a negative almost $500,000. Now, let me kind of stop there and talk about a few things before everybody says, oh man, you know, we lost $500,000. Doesn't look like we had a good year. Well, that $495,000, a lot of that, or the majority of that, ate up restricted fund balance. So those deposits that y'all had already earmarked money for, the unrestricted fund balance actually went up almost $300,000 between 2011 and 2012. And to refresh council memory, when y'all had passed the budget for this year, y'all had budgeted over $1 million that y'all were going to use of unrestricted reserves that y'all didn't even tap into. So before, you know, everybody looks and says, you know, well, we had a bad year. Well, not necessarily. You had a pretty good year. You didn't use the $1 million in reserves, and actually you grew your unrestricted fund balance by about $300,000. So to me, council and the county administrator and finance director and everybody, the department head should, you know, should be congratulated for that. So I just wanted to let y'all know those figures before you kind of thought about, you know, the year might have been bad. It really wasn't as bad as what the numbers come out to be. The sewer fund, total assets are $20.8 million. Total liabilities are $10.4 million, which leaves a fund balance of almost $10.5 million. Fund balance or net assets for the sewer fund are made up of $9.8 million is invested in capital assets, which most of your fund balance is going to be in capital assets. Restricted is for debt services, but over $600,000, which leaves an unrestricted fund balance of $33,000. Last year, that number was a negative over $300,000. So once again, you know, you are starting to build a little bit of reserve now in the sewer fund. Total revenues were $1.5 million. Expenditures, including the other, which is your interest payments on your bond payments, is about $1.4 million. Your other transfers and some other financing sources were about $600,000. So your positive change in fund balance for the sewer fund was $680,000 this year. Just a couple other notes that we've talked about in the past, your OPEB obligation, which deals with your health insurance. That obligation is now almost $1.4 million. It increased a little over $150,000 this year. There again, you know, the only thing basically the county is doing right now is kind of pay as you go. And you're not in about the same boat as everybody else is. Your obligation far outweighs what you're paying right now. And so the only thing I would say is, you know, council continue to look at your health benefits and see if there's any, you know, restructuring that might need to be done, or if we feel like that it's as good as we can do right now. We just have to, you know, deal with the obligation when it comes up. Revenues exceeded your budget for the general fund by over $300,000. Your expenditures were under budget by over $500,000. And this is where I was talking about the transfers that you didn't use. You had budgeted almost $1.3 million in transfers, which a lot of that was to be used from reserves that you didn't use. So your transfers didn't exceed your budget amount by $1.3 million. But like I said, there again, that got back to you didn't use a lot of your reserves that you had planned on using for this year. So overall, it was a good report. I'd like to take the time to thank Vic and Angie, especially Angie and her staff for all the hard work. This is the earliest we have ever had the audit done. So, you know, a big thanks should go out to their staff for a lot of the hard work. I'll be open for any questions. I know you just got the audit report. If at any time you have questions, you can feel free to call myself or Tony. We'll be more than happy to answer whatever questions you have.
I have a question.
Go ahead.
I want to go back to the sewer fund.
Okay.
And the numbers make it look great. a question about it. I'm just really not so long. You know, all the monies we're talking about, when you talk about we have a reserve, we're finally building a reserve with our debt service and everything else. Bottom line is that is revenue from the taxpayers and revenue from the customers that we have on hand that generate that money, correct?
That is correct.
Okay, then since we're doing so great, how much is it costing the taxpayers in this entire county who would ever receive sewer service for us to have a positive? Versus what is the revenue from the customers? I think we have, how many customers? 1,500? And what is the average payment that one of our customers make? I think it runs about close to sometimes $70, $80 a month.
The revenue just from charges from sewer is $1.1 million.
Okay.
The other revenue is made up of impact fees, there's other charges, and some of that money was it was actually some money from, I believe it was Progress Energy had given some money for some expansions on some sewer.
Do we know what revenue we have generated through the taxpayers?
I believe as I'm looking at it, that would be the transfer from special revenue fund.
Yeah, the money that is transferred.
$600,000.
The money that is transferred from the special revenue fund, that is correct.
And then the debt service fund.
That would deal with the sewer tax district that was set up, and the other is for the debt service bond payment. So that makes up about $600,000.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Any other questions? Well, thank you, Mr. Wood. We appreciate it very much. Thank you for your job. I'd like to also recognize our administrator, Dick Carpenter, and Angie Holmes, our Director of Finance, for controlling expenses. Seating as well. Thank you. Next item on the agenda is approval of amendments from November 27th, 2012. The Chair will entertain a motion.
So moved, Mr. Chair.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. Unanimous. Next, we have an ordinance. It's part of the agenda. This is the third reading of an ordinance adopting an amendment to the comprehensive plan by the overview. The Chair will entertain a motion.
So moved, Mr. Chair.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Any discussion?
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Jones.
Questions?
Yes, sir.
The questions that I asked the auditors about the sewer service, it just sort of trickles down to a concern that I have about the comprehensive plan, and maybe somebody here can help me understand and give me some clarification. I don't know. I think to be successful in any county, and I've talked with other counties, you have to certainly have county-owned sewer, but you also have to have public-private sewer and private sewer. You've got to be able to spread out, diversify. You can't just control it yourself and I think be successful. I don't see anywhere in the comprehensive plan that it addresses anything about working with private sectors on sewer and or public-private sewer. If it's there, can someone show me?
And if I may, Mr. Chairman, I would just remind council that we've entered into an agreement, legally binding agreement already, that we pretty much tie our hands at this stage, except in fairly small exceptions to work with private sewer. All of the capacity has been allocated and service territories have been assigned. Having said that, we are starting the process of working proactively and positively with a private sewer company to allow them to expand as logical to service the growth of their area. So I think we are starting that process, but we're still governed by in a legally binding agreement that we have entered into with several others as well that would limit growth of private sewer.
And you're exactly right, we have done that, and I want to commend this council for doing that, and I truly mean that. I think it was a new day for Kershaw County when we got the votes to move forward to let those people get that service, to get the construction started and move in that direction. I commend my colleagues for that. I just had that concern and I understand that this five-year comprehensive plan is nothing but a basic roadmap that has no teeth in it We don't have to follow it. We certainly don't have the money to enforce it. But it is a good outline we have to have, that we have to think about down the road. I'm just saying, guys, we're in different times. The economy's tough. In different times, you have to do business different. You have to think different. And that's my point. Thank you, I'm through.
Any other comments? That concludes the discussion. We have a motion, we have a second. All in favor, raise your right hand. Unanimous. First reading of an ordinance amending the zoning classification of Sun Valley subdivision from R15 to RD2. I want to ask Mr. Carpenter to comment on this, please.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Last night, the Planning Commission voted to send this to council. What it is, essentially, is we have a community that when countywide zoning was enacted, it was zoned part of a countywide plan to R15. R15 is a more exclusive level of zoning that upon further reflection, it does not reflect the nature of the neighborhood. The nature of the neighborhood is predominantly mobile homes and modular housing. And what has triggered this is a homeowner has requested the ability to allow a family member to put a mobile home on a piece of property that used to have a mobile home. By changing the zoning to R15, they couldn't do that. So they requested that we rezone to allow this to happen, and it makes sense to rezone the entire neighborhood as opposed to just a single lot to allow it. So this is requested from the homeowner. The homeowner has submitted to the Planning Commission a petition that was signed by pretty much everybody in the neighborhood. It comes to the council with the Planning Commission unanimous support to ask for it.
And I think we have precedent for this, as I recall. We had something about a year ago.
Yes, we did.
Okay. Any other questions for Mr. Carpenter?
Motion to approve first reading.
Do we have a second?
I second.
Any discussion?
Yes. I would like to say that this is an absolute example of government gone wrong, mandating issues on citizens that just don't make any sense. And I want to commend this council. I hope I'm going to commend this council on first reading of passing this issue. Thank you.
Any other comments? All in favor, raise your right hand. It's unanimous. Next ordinance is a first reading of an ordinance authorizing the conveyance of real property on Pheasant Walk. Mr. Carpenter, would you?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. In essence, what's happening here is CFUNC is agreed to pave a road called Pheasant Walk. In order to accomplish that, there is a very small piece of land, a sliver of land, that must be swapped with the homeowner. The law requires anytime we give up property, the council must vote to approve it. So by authorizing this conveyance, it'll allow the group to pay this road to go forward.
Any other questions for Mr. Carter? Chair will entertain a motion regarding the first reading.
Motion to approve first reading.
Do we have a second?
Second. I yield, Mr. Smith.
Any discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. It's unanimous. Next, we have new business. We have a presentation by the Equine Center, Ms. Laura Scholl.
Thank you very much for your time this evening. I am Laura Scholl, and I'm honored to serve as the chairman of the South Carolina Equine Promotion Foundation. The nonprofit foundation oversees the management and operation of Kershaw County's South Carolina Equine Park. The park was proudly opened in 2009 and has continued to grow every year since. But we are currently limited in our growth because to continue to grow our facility existing as it is today will not work for us to continue our growth. Our economic impact has been great, but it could be even greater. The 2012 economic impact for the South Carolina Equine Park and other operating event facilities has been quantified by the American Horse Council in Washington, D.C., and is based on the formula directly relating to the number of horses engaged in competition at the site. The formula assigns $150 per horse times three, which is the average number of people that travel with each horse, times three again, which is our average number of event days for a competition. The formula would include impact in terms of accommodations, restaurant, retail, and gasoline sales, and accounts for the differing lengths of stay and the higher or lower hotel occupancy depending on a particular event. The South Carolina Equine Park welcomed 2,943 overnight horses this year and 672 day trippers that came from within driving distance, for a total of 3,615 horses in competition at the park this year, which is our highest number since our opening. So using the formula, the estimate for activity at the South Carolina Equine Park for 2012 is over $4.6 million. In addition, the board of the South Carolina Equine Promotion Foundation invited two nonprofit organizations to host their events at the park at little or no cost. The Walter M. Crowe Animal Shelter hosted the Dog and Pony Show, and the South Carolina Horsemen's Council hosted their annual expo. And in spirit of supporting our youth, there was one Western and one English high school horse show were also accepted to our calendar, bringing the use of 32 weekends at the park this year. But we need to stay competitive. The South Carolina Equine Park is a huge contributor to the equine cluster in Kershaw County and has significant impact on the hospitality industry, equine supply industry, and gasoline suppliers. This has not gone unnoticed by other communities. Just last month, Myrtle Beach announced that they wanted to have an interest in building a horse park like the one in Camden. There is not a significant equine cluster in that area, but there is, however, extensive hospitality dollars to accomplish this task. Aiken also has an active committee with the chairman to build a $40 million international horse park. Additionally, North Carolina legislature is planning significant investment in the equine industry throughout their state. We believe that this is the time to aggressively pursue our next capital improvement, which is the building of a second covered arena. The estimated total cost for that arena would be between $800,000 and $1 million. In order to make that number more manageable, we would like to proceed in phases. The first phase would be for engineering, design, and site preparation work. In the package you guys received earlier today, there are more specific numbers and information for phase one. We are very aware that there are so many great projects in Kershaw County for you to financially support. But we strongly believe, and our numbers show, that ours provides the county a great return on your dollars that you invest with us. So we sincerely hope that you will recognize that and continue to help and support us in our wonderful county. Thank you again for your time. And remember that in Kershaw County, our horses really do mean business.
Thank you.
Laura, I'm sorry, I had just one question. Thank you for all the information. What's a, and I know you can't predict the rate in which you'll be able to raise the profit side of this, but is there any sort of time frame if this the council sees fit to grant the request?
Well, I don't have a specific answer to that question, but I will say that initially, when we started trying to get this project going several years ago, county, the city, everybody was very supportive, but our private support was just surprisingly and overwhelmingly great. I think at this point, what we really need is to get this phase one done so that we then can have a plan and a design and a site prepared for it. It's a whole lot easier to raise private funds if you can say, here's exactly what we're looking to do, the site is prepared, here's the design, here's where it's gonna be. So no, I can't give you any specific timeline, but as I said, we would like to do it in phases, and this would be our first phase, hopefully, in our first step to the ultimate goal.
Great, thanks.
Any other questions, or sorry?
That's it, thank you. Next up, we have a presentation by Mr. Galloway from the Kershaw County Chamber of Commerce.
Thank you, Chairman, Councilman. My name is Chip Galloway, President of the Kershaw County Chamber of Commerce, and we are an organization who use the Equine Park for our board retreat this year. We got a wonderful tour and we're able to use the facilities, so we want to thank you very much for that. I'm here tonight to request local ATAX fund the amount of $45,000 for capital improvement projects for the historic Robert Mills Courthouse. 2 years ago, the Chamber requested funds totaling $150,000 for capital improvement projects. We received $45,000 as part of that initial request in 2010. We were able to cover some of our projects that were liability issues, such as replacement of the porch and complete repair and restoration of the hardwood floors on the second floor of the courthouse. Almost all of our current funding is tied up with day-to-day operations with the Chamber of Commerce and the County's Visitor Center, with little resources left for needed preservation of the historic facility. However, the Chamber has contributed to the maintenance, repairs, and restoration of the facility in the past couple of years, to include interior painting where water seepage has caused damage, renovations to the public restrooms in the Visitor Center, replacement of the water pump and the elevator shaft, electrical repairs, repairs to the elevator. We have ordered a new HVAC unit to be installed soon to repair the upstairs unit that has quit this past summer. The historic Robert Mills Courthouse is one of the most significant landmarks in Kershaw County, designed in 1825. It presently serves as the base operation for the Kershaw County Chamber of Commerce and is also a designated welcome center for Kershaw County. This facility is often the first impression that tourists get of potential new residents to our county. During the past 2 years, our data logs indicate approximately 10,000 visitors coming physically to stopping at the Robert Mills Courthouse from almost all 50 states and numerous foreign destinations. The Chamber has received roughly 50,000 inquiries in the past 2 years through a combination of leads to our advertising partners, mail requests, phone calls, web inquiries, and walk-ins. The Chamber and Visitor Center provides Kershaw County throughout the year and serves as ambassadors of visitors coming to our community. We provide visitors with information, directions prior to and during their visits, information about local businesses, events, and attractions, and also serve as a welcome rest stop for many travelers. The facility is utilized throughout the years for weddings, receptions, and other special events, to include Santa Claus being there tonight. So when y'all leave here, if you want to go by and see Santa Claus, I saw him earlier when he's there. The facility averages about 20 weddings and receptions annually in addition to other special events. Having the facility in optimal shape is potential to increase the number of events hosted by our facilities, thus allowing us to become more financially independent in our operations. Not only do these events generate revenue for the Chamber and Visitor Center, but also generates auxiliary revenue to the county through taxes. The list of projects are included in your packet. With the number one priority, repair to the windows in the facilities. If you walk by the facility now and you knock on the windows, they rattle. The glazing around the windows is coming off, and that's one of the products we're going to work on. And also on the inside of the buildings, we're going to put up storm windows, magnetic storm windows on the inside, to improve the efficiency of the heating and air systems once we get the new one installed. And that's part of the projects that we have coming up. The additions would not hinder the historical significance of the facility in any way and could easily be taken down, cleaning and repairs the window. I'm talking about the storm windows on the inside. The operation and upkeep of the first-class visitor center is a key ingredient to drawing visitors to our county, and we would sincerely appreciate your support on our funding request tonight. Do y'all have any questions?
Any questions? Thank you. Yes.
You talk about 10,000 visitors. Is there any way for you to measure the economic impact of those 10,000 visitors? And how do you do that?
We have in your packet, and it's about a two-year-old conversion of the inquiries that we have total as far as walk-in visitors, websites, and it's the calculation rate for room night converted is in your packet. And the, let's see, with 50,000 inquiries with a conversion at 72,495 total room nights. And that was a conversion based off of 2006 conversion study. That's based over the last 2 years that we've had. And that will generate about $100,000 in A-tax revenue. And what we've done is our initial request was $150,000, and 2 years ago we had $45,000. We have prioritized our request for this time, and we've cut everything we can cut. There's nothing extra in there as far as our request goes to bring the facility up to standards. We've contributed through our budget. And we're asking for the bare minimum.
Mr. Tucker.
Thanks, Chair. You guys also have done some project work this year to this courthouse, some things that you had to do prior to this restoration of what
we have. We've had issues with our elevator and had to, we have water issues that were coming up through the ground, and we had to replace the pump in the elevator. We've done renovations to the public restrooms downstairs that visitors come in and they use. And the HVAC unit went out this summer, and we've contracted to get it replaced. It's more of a summertime issue upstairs than it is wintertime, so time is not of the essence, but we've already have the funds secured for it. We already have it in place, and we're just waiting for that to take place. So that's what we put in place through our budget.
Any other questions? Okay, Mr. Elway, thank you for your time.
I don't know if this is the appropriate time, but I am prepared to make a motion whenever you decide that you want
to. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mr.
Elway.
We have $383,000 left in our capital fund. The chair would like to disperse this money. It's our capital money, it's one-time money.
You're going to go ahead and explain.
I'm explaining. Yes. And I guess it's a holiday season, so we'll make some people hopefully happy here. But so we have $383,000. We've been reviewing, sitting on this money for over a year, and I think it's time to disperse it. So with that, I want to yield to Mr. Jones to make a motion.
Yeah, I thought you were going to go into more in depth. Anyway, I agree with the chairman 100%. The money's been sitting there for over a year. The money needs to go back out into the community. It's your money. It's not ours. And I want to see some activity from it. I'm going to make the motion that we disperse that money in this manner. The Equine Center, $250,000. The Chamber of Commerce. And let me go back to the Equine Center. Let's not forget what she said, Ms. Teal, about the capital investment being near $2 million, and that they have $800,000 to a $1.2 million project going on, and they need $250,000 to help get it started in the phase. And let's not forget about the Chamber of Commerce, which I'm going to recommend $45,000. Folks, they still handle.
So Chairman, point of order. You know, we can discuss what Mr. Jones' motion is after he makes the motion.
All right, and I stand corrected.
Thank you.
Equine Center, $250,000. The Chamber, $45,000. Historic Camden, $41,500. County Tourism or Signs, $46,500. And we've already given the Fine Arts Center $50,000. But anyway, that has nothing to do with this motion. I just want to make that point of reference. That would total $383,000.
Second, Mr. Chair.
We have a motion, we have a second. Discussion, please.
Okay. And Mr. Smoke, I apologize. You are absolutely right, I made a mistake. I got carried away with the excitement. And there should be a reason for excitement, because folks can get to work and start, you know, we're putting this money into the community. But I was just talking about the $800,000 to $1.2 million project that the Equine Center has. You know, this is going to really help them get it jump started. And they really have a foundation for raising private funds as well. And I personally appreciate everything that y'all do. And when we talk about the Chamber, The chamber handles our visitor's center. Guys, we have to have a chamber of commerce, regardless of what some may think or not. I mean, what if we didn't? So Chip, I commend you guys. You've done a great job, and I appreciate everything you do.
Any other comments? Mr. Smoke.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to clarify a couple of things. This money has actually been sitting there for not 1 year, but 8 to 10 years. I don't know. How many years, Mr. Carpenter, do you wear?
Long time.
Since the previous council 10 years ago or so enacted the accommodations tax. So it's actually been sitting there
It actually was $600,000 at one point.
Right. And it's been sitting there for a long time. And just so the public and everyone will know going forward, when Mr. Wise, our chairman, says one time that this is one-time money, it truly is, in that future accommodations tax revenues are obligated towards our tourism department and running it and providing for some of their capital needs. So this really is one-time money. I mean, this will never, ever, you know, be there again unless the future council decides to get rid of the tourism department and the tourism director, and which we don't intend to do anytime soon, at least I don't. I saw a sad face out there in the audience. But so it really is, and so you know, we hope, of course, that this will be put to good use. And that's not to say that, you know, if some other source became available, that we wouldn't support these same organizations in the future, but it just won't be from this amount of money from the ATAX fund. So just wanted to clarify that.
Thank you. Any other comments?
Mr. Chair, yes, one sir. Quick comment. I'd like to thank my colleagues for doing the right thing. Now, if they vote against it, I take that back.
Thank you. We have a motion. We have a second. We conclude the discussion. All in favor, please raise your right hand. Unanimous. Next item on the agenda, the Sheriff's Department, Edward Byrd Memorial Justice Assistant Grant, Assistance Grant. We talked about this during the public hearing, the $16,000 grant. The Chair will entertain a motion regarding this.
So moved, Chair.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Any discussion?
Can we quickly have just a little bit of clarification from the Sheriff?
Please. Sheriff?
Briefly. Well, in your office, I can't tell you what to do.
Well, these cameras are going to be used in, I think it's 16,000 is what this is?
Yes.
So about five cameras. He's going to the patrol cars. They record traffic stops. A lot of times they record incidents with the civilians. They keep the deputies honest. They keep the citizens that they deal with honest. They reduce our liability. It's industry standard. Very few agencies do not have them, so we are making a concerted effort to get them. We've gotten $15,000 from the Sheriff's Foundation. I think we have some other grants as well that we're trying to get all of our cars equipped with cameras.
Thank you.
Chairman.
Mr. Small.
And following up on that, have you, Sheriff, or somebody from your office carefully reviewed those conditions that the member of the public mentioned earlier? The grant conditions or stipulations?
No, I have not. I don't know that anybody has. I'll tell you this, that as far as sharing information that we get from a traffic stop or some type of an international conglomerate or database, these traffic stops, we keep these things for about 90 days and then they're erased. We don't share them with anybody. However, if in the course of a crime spree or something, we made a traffic stop and we were able to determine that the person that was wanted is on that. That information will be shared with whatever law enforcement agency that needs it, whether it be SLED, other sheriff's office, police departments, highway patrol, whoever. But as far as us routinely submitting our camera findings to an organization, we don't do that.
OJP requirements?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I don't know that there's even a requirement. I don't think anybody does it. I think it might just be some language that's in the grant language, but I don't know anybody who does that.
All right, so is there any other concern that your office has about accepting this grant?
Absolutely not.
And then in your mind, there's no doubt that this is in the best interest of Kershaw County for us to accept this money?
Totally.
Mr. Tucker?
Hey, Chair, I mean, you guys are with your the way that you conduct your business and the way that the law is written that you enforce, I mean, things are very confidential amongst the law enforcement agencies that you have to deal with. So it's not like you're on YouTube every day.
No.
Publishing your information. I mean, it's treated no different than what you're doing now.
Much more information is gained through a driver's license check and a criminal history check following a traffic stop than would be from a camera. A camera documents a stop. I recently saw one, it was in North Charleston, where an officer was out of line, appeared that he was out of line in handling a suspect. And that's Freedom of Information Act recoverable, and it will be used in a disciplinary action, I'm sure. It keeps everybody honest. And if I have an officer who is out of line, I'm going to know about it, and the camera will record it. And if a citizen makes an unsupported, frivolous complaint, and it can be, you can look at it, review the film, I want to know about that as well. It reduces the county's liability.
Sure. You and I recently just had a conversation. Councilman Tucker was involved in it as well. I have received a complaint of possibly some abuse from one of your officers on Interstate I-95, working with another agency. It was pretty damaging statements that were made. I-85 was, I can remember. And the video, absolutely, Councilman Tucker watched it with me. He's
totally exonerated.
Question. There would have always been doubt in the mind, because the complaint I got came from a very prominent, legitimate person in our community, and they were concerned that there might be some overbearing police brutality or whatever, but it was not the case by no means whatsoever. So.
Thank you, Chair. Any other questions?
Any other comments? We have a motion. We have a second. All in favor, raise your right hand. Unanimous. Next item is a resolution establishing council.
Mr. Chair.
We have a second.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand.
So.
Unanimous.
Mr. Chairman, the clerk will say who made the motion. I'm sorry.
Gary, and seconded by Gardner.
Next, the Tucker, we have a proclamation.
Yes.
Usually I talk last, but tonight I want to talk first. Sheriff's prerogative.
Well, I have something I want to say too.
Well, I'm going to let you guys talk. Yeah. Mr. Bobby Gary is, this is his last meeting, and we have a resolution recognizing and honoring him. And I'd like to read that. Whereas Robert Lee Gary is a lifelong resident of Kershaw County, whereas Robert Lee Gary is known to his family, friends, constituents, and citizens as Bobby Gary. Where Bobby Gary is married to Bernadette S. Gary and has three children, Bobby J. Gary, Abigail Gary, and Joshua J. Gary. Whereas Bobby Gary is the son of Robert K. Gary and May R. Gary. Whereas Bobby Gary is a member of St. Matthew's Baptist Church. Whereas Bobby Gary is a tireless advocate for helping the homeless, the hungry, and those less fortunate. Whereas Bobby Gary is a devoted sports fan and has served as a basketball coach in many capacities. Whereas Bobby Gary is a community advocate for the betterment of Kershaw County. Whereas Bobby Gary has served on Kershaw County Council since January the 2nd, 2009. It is therefore resolved by Kershaw County Council that Kershaw County Council recognizes and honors Robert Lee Gary for his service to the citizens of Kershaw County Council and recognizes him for his service on Kershaw County Council. Resolved by Kershaw County Council this 11th day of December, 2011.
12.
12, excuse me. Mr. Gary. Thank you. And on a personal note, I would just like to state, people ask me about various council members, and they ask me about Bobby Gary. I always say he's the conscience of county council. I'll be looking in the budget at line items and this and that, and Bobby will elbow me and say, well, what about the hungry? What about the homeless? He grounds me. He brings me back to what's important here. So I really appreciate that for what he does for all the folks here in Kershaw County. Thank you, Mr. Gary. And I wish you well in your further endeavors.
I would like to make a motion to accept the resolution.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. It's unanimous. We're going to have Mr. Miles sign this.
Yes, then we're going to get a frame as well.
We'll get a frame as well. Mr. Gardner, any comments tonight on council briefings?
Just to say thank you to Mr. Gary for his service to Kershaw County. It's been a pleasure serving with you for these 2 years. Wish you well and for future endeavors. And Merry Christmas, Gary.
Mr. Jones?
I would also like to commend Councilman Bobby Gary on his service to Kershaw County. He was elected by the people. He served them well, and I wish you the best in the future. I have just a couple of things I want to say since this is the end of the year for this county council. And this is on a personal note, and some may say, well, what does it have to do with county council? Well, it has nothing to do with county council, but I was elected to this seat, so I will take the opportunity to say what I feel. Unless people want to vote me out in 2 years. 2012 has been a very good year. Obviously, county council, county employees, staff, county administrator have done a great job based on the audit report. There's still a lot of discussion, still a lot of dialogue that we're going to have to make sure that things are running right. I want to commend staff, commend Mr. Carpenter on their flexibility. They've been able to work outside the black and white, go into the gray areas when you're dealing with human beings. And I appreciate that. I just want you and your staff to know that very much. Now, on a more personal note, those are the good things. The yucky things of 2012 is I've lost two best friends, one, Joey Dorton, which I know we all are aware of, who was like a brother to me, a family member who was killed in an accident August 1st. But just a week ago, I lost my other best friend, and that was Tug, our dog, for 10 years. Tug's sitting there with Obama, our cat, on the bed. And, you know, we rescued Tug from down the shelter. And he always waited on me to get him up in the morning. If he wasn't ready to get up, I'd have to go to the coffee club, come back, and then get him out of bed about 9:30 or 10. And I used to get a lot of ragging from my colleagues at the coffee club about that. But Tug was a good member of our family. We loved him, but I don't think we've ever loved him as much as he loved us, and we're going to miss him. But this is my way of honoring my second best friend that I lost in 2012. And I want to thank the Kershaw County Humane Society for everything that they do. Thank you.
Mr. Smoke.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I simply wanted to speak to Councilman Gary's service to this body as well and thank him for that. He's worked vigorously for the people of his district and all of the people of Kershaw County. And I think we can all say without a doubt that Councilman Gary's heart has always been in the right place as to the causes that he's stood for during the past 40 years. I've enjoyed serving with you, my friend. Best of luck in all your future endeavors.
Mr. Tucker.
Thank you. I guess I can just say ditto, Bobby, but I want to tell you thank you personally. And don't let this year end your ventures of continuing to serve the people. You're a young man who has a bright future and there's a lot more other interesting things out there that you can be doing. Someday I look for you to be sitting right up here when you decide to do that or in another capacity. And I would just like to thank all the public colleagues allowing me to serve another year and to say Merry Christmas and Happy Holidays.
Thank you. Thanks again, Bobby. Appreciate it. I know we'll see you in the future. But on behalf of all the council members, we'd like to wish all the citizens of Kershaw County and all the employees of Kershaw County a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Next, administrator's briefing. Oh, I forgot Mr. Gary. Sorry.
He's got a farewell speech. I see it over there.
Sorry about that.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I would just like to say it has truly been an honor serving the people of District Number One and also the people of Kershaw County. And also it's been an honor serving with my colleagues, Smoke, Tucker, Miles, Chairman Wise, Councilman Gardner, Councilman Jones, Councilman Elliott, Councilman Ford, Councilman Kelly. It truly has been an honor serving with you guys. We had our ups and downs, but we pushed through and moved forward for Kershaw County Council. And also, I'd like to say, on December 24th, we will be doing a feeding for all the hungry and homeless at the Kershaw County Recreation Department at 2 o'clock. If you'd like to assist or even help or bring some type of food, please come out on December 24th at Kershaw County Recreation Department or just get in touch with me. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Carpenter?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of council. Just a few items. Again, I'd like to invite the community this year again, as we did last year. County employees are having their own little Santa's workshop upstairs. This is an example of the spirit of our county employees and the community's generosity in donating all the resources that went into building Santa's workshop. So everybody is welcome to come by and visit, and Santa will be here as well later on in December. I'd like to echo what has been said by members of council in expressing the appreciation I have to members of our finance staff as well as our department heads. I take great pride in the report that was presented to the council because county staff did an excellent job in managing the resources that have been entrusted to them. And I think it's indicative of the job that they do for you, the council. So I appreciate that. I'd like also to let council know that a grant has been awarded to Kershaw County by DHEC for $534,000 to allow the construction of a septage receiving station at Kershaw County's wastewater treatment plant that will accept waste from haulers from Kershaw, Fairfield, and Richland County. This was one of only two grants that they gave out in the entire state. It was 100% grants. There's no match required for this. And it's, again, I think, an example of where we're going with our county departments and the recognition that we're receiving across the state that they gave us this level of support from DHEC. And finally, I would like to remind members of council, we will not be meeting on Christmas Day. If you show up, the doors will be locked, and there will be no effort made in unlocking for you. And with that, Mr. Chairman, that's our report.
Thank you. Mr. DeBose?
Mr. Chairman, members of council, I have no report on this last county council meeting of the year.
Mr. Gary.
Close to adjourn.
We have a second.
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Meeting adjourned.
Mr. Bowles, thank you, sir.